London again?
Yeah, after some time. You know, it's been a while. You know, I mean, a good 2 years. I think that project with Mary Baraka and David Mary, I think that might have been like 2 years ago. Yeah. And you know who was at that project? Richard Nichols from The Roots, the manager, who died.
Yeah.
You know, he was there. I remember seeing him backstage because The Roots was there, Questlove and, you know, Black Thought.
You know, so. It was a big project, wasn't it?
That was a huge project. Yeah. It didn't do anything. It was pretty much a pilot, you might say.
Yeah.
Where they were just testing the waters. A lot of David Mary stuff he does like that. The projects are so huge. Now, the thing that he did with Macy Gray, that took off.
Yeah.
And they was doing that around. But a few of the things that he does from time to time, you know, they're sort of work in progress kind of things. And that project was pretty huge, you know. Tongues on Fire, that's what it was called.
Tongues on Fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right, I remember. And there was another project which you did together with him with Boots Riley.
Yeah. Sisyphus. And Sisyphus Syndrome.
Right.
And Mary was on that as well. So, you know. So that was the last time I was in London. But I like London. But this, I must say, though, this time I had an opportunity to be in an area that I kind of felt that I knew, you know, or that I, you know, I felt kind of felt close to somehow. Was it Dalston it's called?
Yeah.
You know, for some reason. I see a lot of people of color, you know. Mm. You know, it's the hood, you know.
Yeah.
I like that.
You know, it's kind of homey, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, like every place, you know, that I've been thus far, you know, which I haven't been here a lot, but, you know, there were certain areas where it was like, okay, you know, here's, you know. But I mean, gentrification has touched most parts of the world, and I see that happening here as well.
Of course.
You know, I just hope that all the black people not completely ran out. You know?
Yeah, yeah. You know? I think some of us are still here.
Okay, well, that's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful thing. London is going through some changes, just like America, and you know, everybody has to buckle down and batten the hatches and try to figure out how to get through this stuff, because you know, it's very messy, and you have to be spiritual, and you have to be secure within yourself to be able to get through this crap, because if you're not, you know, they're going to have you jumping out the window, you know, slitting, cutting your wrists.
Eating nails,
you know, or whatever, you know, and I ain't doing none of that, you know, I mean, get up in the morning and make my prayer and let the Creator handle everything that's supposed to be handled, you know, and that doesn't mean that I'm just going to sit on my laurels and just, you know, sit down. No, I'm going to get up and try to, you know, make things happen, but ultimately it you know, it has to do with, you know, how you see things to be, and, you know.
It's still a battle, though, isn't it?
I mean, yeah, it's still a battle.
Even, you know, this, you know, your work, you know, very well, and you've been doing it for quite some time now.
Right. And my work is like, you know, it's, I mean, like, when I first did my first album on Grammy Vision Records, Showstopper, they didn't really know where to place me then.
Yeah.
They didn't know where to, you know, I mean, because the record was so diverse,
right,
which I think people's ears have caught up to.
Yeah.
You know, but at that time, I mean, that record had Wilhelmina Fernandez.
Mm-hmm.
She's a vocalist, the singer, opera singer.
Mm-hmm.
She was in the movie Diva, and she was on the record. I had Chuck Hammer. He was a guitar player with David Bowie. He was on the record. James Blood Omer was on the record.
Mm-hmm.
Then I had my band. I had Ornette Coleman on one piece. You know, well, Ornette wrote a piece for me called Tacuma Song. And so the record was, you know, pretty going in so many different directions. But that's just me. That's how I am.
Yeah, that sounds very nice.
You know, and I mean, I can't help for being that way. That's just musically, even as a producer, I'm producing different, you know, various artists. One artist might be a lounge kind of singer, you know, and another artist might be just a straight hip-hop artist, and another thing might be this free jazz or improvisational concept. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I don't try to catch it with them. They should try to catch it with me.
Yeah.
And I am not going to belittle the people that I work with or even myself to try to fit into any kind of mold. I mean, like, I try to do the best music that I can do, recording-wise and live performance-wise. And I think the people who get it, they get it, you know. And I'm not going to run around and try to, like, you know, with a big banner, like, come check me out, you know. No, I'm not doing it, you know. And I mean, I've been experiencing something this past month that's been pretty interesting as well. The whole concept of the academia, which is pretty cool, because I've been invited to some residencies. I've been doing that recently, mm-hmm. doing some master classes, and, you know, that's something kind of out of my realm, but I figured out how to do that in explaining improvisation to students who are interested in that. Mm-hmm. But I, that's one side of it. The other side, you know, so the folks that do these residencies, they also start to write these grants to be able to try to get money.
Right.
And I see something really strange in that, because if you're trying to do a concert, right, and you asking someone to give you money to do that concert, you know what you want to do. They don't know what you want to do. You can explain to them all you want, mm-hmm. but if they don't really have if they don't really believe in it, or they don't really have an idea about it, or they, you know, it goes through this filtering system, whereas if you're not saying the right thing, you're not going to get the money.
That's it.
You know, and I mean,
certain buzzwords you have to use.
Buzzwords. I mean, come on. I mean, I would rather not have the money to be able to, like, you know, sort of keep explaining. Mm. Keep explaining something that, you know, at the end of the day, you're going to either tell me yes or no, based on a room filled with people who are already programmed as to what they already think about certain things or whatever.
Right.
Now, I might be considered hardcore in that way as an artist, but mm-hmm. that's just the way I see it. If I'm asking somebody for $10,000 to do a show or whatever, to do whatever project mm-hmm. that I want to do, mm-hmm. and if they don't get it, if this is a corporation and they don't get it, I'd rather ask somebody private or raise the money myself.
Yeah.
You know, go out and sell lemonade.
There are ways of finding that.
Yeah, you know, whatever. That doesn't pull me through that kind of situation. I'm a strong believer. I think that the artist has to do. They don't necessarily have to say. They just have to do, you know. And it's not like one of my friends was saying, that it's not about what you say, it's about what you do. I've always been a believer of that.
Yeah.
And going through this, that past experience, it just confirms that. It's not about what you say, it's about what you do. My career, I've been doing what I've been doing now for 30 years or more, and I mean, I think that should speak for itself. I mean, you know, I try to be humble with it,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not putting myself in a position where I want to belittle myself in terms of what I've been trying to do, what I'm trying to continue to do. So it's a balance. It's a fine balance between that, you know. But I just wanted to every day just be happy about what I'm doing. You know, I don't want to start feeling kind of, you know, animosity to the business or blah, blah, blah. I mean, I know the business is basically based on bullshit.
Yeah.
I don't subscribe to that. And I just want to continue to do what I'm doing musically. And if I have to create my own situation or setting to do what I want to do, which so all, so be it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, every day I'm still going to eat somehow.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that I'm not doing this to be, you know, things come to me, you know, I don't ask for things, things come to me, you know, and so, you know, I look at that as being a blessing, so.
Mm. You have a reputation anyway, you know.
Yeah, it's a nice little, it's a nice little foundation, so, and that foundation is based on me doing what I want to do musically, or what I want to do from an artistic point. I mean, I know I've heard about people who've had that experience being artists, you know. I see myself being at that point. It's like, you know, you guys haven't given me $1 million because they only support the people that are in more powerful situations are only supporting something that they feel as though they can get something out of it.
Right.
If they don't feel as though they can get anything out of it, they're not going to put any money or they're not going to put anything into it. But it doesn't mean that the person who's doing whatever they're doing is not
valid.
A value or valid.
Yeah.
You know, they have to themselves believe that is valid. Excess cash flow that they want to just give you. They just want to give it to you so you can do your art, you know?
Right.
And those are the people that I want to meet.
Yeah,
you know, I want to meet those people who believe in art for art's sake and who want to just give you the money with no strings attached.
Right.
You know, they're not going to sit you down and say, well, could you write to me, you know, what do you think about this? What do you think about this? And what are you going to, when you write this piece of music, what are you going to get out of it?
Mm.
What do you want somebody else to get out of it?
Mm.
I want them to listen to the music. I want them to get out of it, whatever they want to get out of it.
Yeah.
You know?
Corporations have another attitude, though. It's like, it's again going back to the system of performing for the king.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the jester hat, you know, blah, 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 blah.
The pointed toed shoes with the balls jingling and jangling.
Right. And I'm sure there were some artists who were like looking like, I'm not doing that shit.
Yeah, I'm not wearing that.
I'm not doing that.
I'm not wearing that kit.
I ain't wearing that shit.
Yeah.
I'm not doing that.
Mm-hmm.
They probably weren't successful.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they probably had their little underground scene that was going on,
mm-hmm.
you know, amongst themselves, or you know, and that was cool. And I'm sure there were some people from the court that was sneaking, checking out that set, you know.
Yeah. And some of those people who actually worked for the king,
right,
probably fell to alcohol or other substances,
right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's the same thing, but it's an interesting point, though.
Mm.
That playing for the king, thing.
Yeah.
That's interesting. That's exactly
mm-hmm.
what it is to a certain extent. Now, I mean, I'm brave enough to say that, you know. I mean, I might not get another dime, but that's okay.
Mm.
I'll put my own show on.
Mm.
If I'm asking somebody for $10,000 and they don't want to give it to me, you know what? I might do it. I might pull that same thing off for $2,000.
Yeah.
You know, and it might not be blah, 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 but it's going to be, and it happened.
Yeah.
And that's all that I care about, right. That it happened. Right. You know, that it took place, the show took place, you know.
That's important. That's the side about because any creative process, that it actually happens in the end.
Yeah, that it happens. Not that you just, you know, you have this money, and then you utilize this money, and the show was like corny.
Yeah.
So you had $20 million to, or $20,000 to do something, but at the end it's corny.
Should have kept the money in your pocket.
Should have kept the money in your pocket. Yeah. You know, and I'll take the. I didn't have the 20. Mm-hmm. I had 3, mm-hmm. But it was a phenomenal event. Folks that's involved in the fashion industry who's making tons of money, you know, and I know other people that's in the music business who are making tons of money. You go to their house, they got gold records on the walls, but they always sitting me down asking me, Jamal, how do you do what you do? I would love to do what you're doing. How do you play that way that you play and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. I'm like, just be you, you know, just so be you.
It's a disappointment. You know, when you do get up at echelons, it does become more and more difficult to be because you've got to keep smiling, you've got to perform, whether it's raining outside or not.
Right. But you can do that without, you know, sort of selling yourself short, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you can still, I prefer to smile. I prefer to smile anyway,
period.
Yeah. If money or no money, I prefer just to be, you know, happy. Happy brings health, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and laughter brings health, so.
But some days you don't feel like, sometimes you don't feel like doing that.
Right.
But then the problem is when you're in that show business, you're forced to do it. And that's where the problem starts.
That's where the problem starts.
Because now you're going against your own emotion.
Right.
This is where problems really begin.
And then again, you know, these people, the music business is set up, the more successful people who've been extremely successful, that's all that they do.
Right.
And I choose not to be that way. I want to be a human being first. Right. So therefore, I want to do other things. Mm-hmm. I want to, when I'm finished my tour, which I play hard every night, when I'm finished that tour, I want to put the guitar aside. I don't want to look at it.
Yeah.
I don't want to look at it.
I remember you said that once
before. I don't want to look at it. I want to go to the movies. I want to go to dinner. I want to go to, a play. I want to go to the opera. I want to shop. I want to spend some of the money that I made when I was on the road. Yeah. I want to take my kids out to the zoo, or blah, 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 blah. Take my wife out to dinner, you know, whatever. You know, I don't want to, you know, the first thing I do after a tour, the next one,
yeah, some grinding again.
Beautiful, you know, 18 years old, you know, going on a road with him for 2 weeks and supposed to be going for 2 weeks and wound up staying in Europe for 6 months, 18 years old, living in Paris, 6 months, you know, with Ornette and studying with him, recording with him, some of the first primetime records. And he was like a mentor. And like I was explaining to you, that they had two celebrations for Ornette Coleman. One was in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. Well, I did something. I invited Wolfgang Puschnick to come over. Mm-hmm. Tony Kofi came over.
Right.
And I had a pianist named Yoichi Uzeki on piano. Mm-hmm. And Asha Puthli, the vocalist, the Indian vocalist who sung with Ornette in 1968 on a record called Science Fiction,
right.
Was a piece on there called What Reason Could I Give? And she had never sung that piece live before. They did it in the studio with Ornette Coleman, Dewey Redman, mm-hmm. and Ed Blackwell, and they had and Charlie Hayden, and they never did that their recording live. I mean, you know, live. And so it was an opportunity. I called her up. She lives in California. Called her up, and she says, "Listen, I would love to do it." You know, mm-hmm. and so she came to Philadelphia, and we did that that performance, and that was good. And so it was Donardo Coleman's Ornette's son. He played with his band, and then I played with my band. And then they had another, that was in Philadelphia. Then they had another celebration for Ornette Coleman in New York. And there they had Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Patti Smith, mm-hmm. Yoko Ono was there, I think. And there was a lot of people that was there from the whole New York scene that was right. there. So that was it was really nice. Yeah.
Great musician, Ornette.
Yeah, Ornette Coleman is an unbelievable creative individual and a great human being. Mm. A lot of things I've learned from him in terms of how to handle a band, for one, how to be a band leader and to be strong without being overly, you know,
overbearing,
you know, mm-hmm. and kind of demanding and commanding respect from the other musicians just by being a kind of respectful guy that you would want to lead them into battle, that they will respect you. You know, and you don't have to do anything extra except just to be yourself to get that kind of respect from them. And I found that out quite early. All the bands I've had, you know, I've always treated the guys with respect and love and understanding and sensitivity. And, you know, I've been able to get, you know, the best performances out of the guys. I mean, like Tony Kofi told me, says, "You know, Jamal, you was the first one that got me playing the tenor saxophone, because when we did the record with Ornette, I had Wolfgang come and Ornette played alto, mm-hmm. but I didn't want all those guys were Ornette. I mean, Tony and Wolfgang were both saxophone players, but I didn't want them to play saxophone like alto saxophone. Mm-hmm. So Wolfgang came and he only played flute and this instrument called a hojack, which is a Korean instrument. Mm-hmm. And Tony came and played the tenor saxophone. And so he said that this was the first time that he had really played the tenor saxophone. Mm-hmm. And every time I see him, he goes, "Jamal, thank you, man, for you know." You know, let me play the tenor saxophone. I say that's cool. You know, but
so Ornette was very important for that.
Yeah,
he was a unique. I mean, he's a unique individual, as a unique artist. His sound was, you know, brought a lot of controversy with it.
In right, exactly. Music. You know, and I understand how he's been able to to have the kind of consistency that he's had, because he just stuck to his guns, you know. He didn't, you know, sort of just like, you know, kind of fall to the wayside or be intimidated, you know.
He didn't back down, did he?
Yeah, he didn't back down. Mm-hmm. And he had his own groups, and that's why he had his own groups, you know. He couldn't really play with anybody else. I mean, he could play with them, but they didn't want him to play, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and he probably wanted to play with somebody else, but, you know, like he always does. You know, you can go to his loft in New York, and he just wants to play with you, you know, all day long and all night, you know. Mm-hmm. And but other people weren't seeing it that way, you know, in terms of him, you know.
Charlie Hayden passed.
Charlie Hayden passed, yep. You know he's like, so Ornette is like the last standing soldier.
Yeah.
You know, Don Cherry, Ed Blackwell, Charles Moffat, you know, who?
Dewey.
Dewey, yep. Yeah. So Ornette's like the, you know, last man standing, you know.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Did you know Charlie Hayden?
I knew Charlie, yep.
Yeah, what do you think?
He was a cool guy. He was pretty interesting in terms of, I mean, we never really, like, you know, we didn't go out to dinner or nothing like that, you know, because he was, like, of a different generation. Mm-hmm. And, you know, of course, you know, primetime band, you know, we'd be playing a little loud. So Charlie always had his earplugs in, you know. It's a lot of people. Actually, when I look at that biography of mine, I look at all the folks that I've, you know, touched base with. You know, yeah, I mean, somehow it's, you know, it's like Peter Murphy from Bauhaus. I mean, you can go from that to like some kids that has this band that I just was recording with in Tokyo. It's a lot of stuff that I've done, and I see it. It's like, wow, you know. And I'm still humble about it, and I'm still, you know, putting myself in a position to learn and to be, you know. That's why it like, was important for me to come here to London for this thing, because I wanted to meet those guys from Black Top. You know, Orphy Robinson and Pat Thomas and Philip Achille on harmonica. I wanted to meet those guys. I wanted to just, and they said that. They said that they were like, you know, they knew that it was going to be some very powerful, energetic thing, you know, happening. And, you know, when we were playing, actually, it was a situation where we were trying to be dynamic, also listening to each other, acting off of each other, but also propelling each other to move forward, you know, musically and creatively on stage. So, you know, that kind of stuff is important to me. So it was important for me to meet these other beings who felt the same way that I feel, you know. Like-minded people, yeah. You know.
Music. Sound work very good, definitely.
Yeah.
Very good show. Yes. So we should be seeing you back here soon, huh?
Yeah, I'm thinking about coming back to London and doing a residency for myself. You know, planning myself in some hotel or some bed and breakfast as my living point, and then communicating and collaborating with these other musicians and fashion people in London. So that's what I'm
gonna come and say support.
I don't know. Wherever, I don't know. But it won't be with that redhead. I'm gonna go get some more.